Good evening, everyone. On behalf of the trustees and staff of the CSMVS, I welcome all of you for another interesting lecture. This lecture today is delivered by my colleague and friend, Nilanjana Som, who I'm very pleased to introduce to all of you. She has 2 master's degrees in medieval Indian history from the University of Delhi and museology from National Museum Institute, New Delhi. She is currently the assistant curator for art with the CSMVS since 2015. She is involved in the documentation and digitization of entire museum collection and also is part of the museum archives. She is also involved in collection management and research of Indian art collections, especially the arms and armor collection. She has worked on several temporary and permanent exhibitions, including the recently opened Money and Jewelry Gallery. She has co-curated the exhibition Traversing Tibet through the lens of Lee Gautami. She coordinated workshop marking 10 years of international training program organized by the British Museum in November 2015. Previously, she has worked with various museums in India on different projects like the Mehrangarh Museum Trust, Jodhpur, the Maharaja Sir Jivaji Rao Sindhya Museum, Gwalior, the Sawai Man Singh II Museum, Jaipur, and the Chaumahala Palace Trust, Hyderabad. In 2014-15, she received the Nehru Trust for Indian Collections in Victoria and Albert Museum Visit Fellowship to study the Indian Arms Collection housed in various museums in UK. During this study, she studied the latest documentation and digitization practices in the museums she visited, which includes the Royal Armouries Leeds, Wallace Collection, Victoria and Albert Museum, the British Museum, Lord Clive Collection at the Powers Castle, Welshpool, and others. Now I invite Nilanjana to deliver her lecture.
I want to thank the museum for giving me this opportunity to talk about the arms collection in the museum. I want to specially thank my seniors, Mr. Mukherjee, DG, CSMVS, and Mrs. Manisha Nene, Director, for their constant guidance and support. I take this opportunity to also thank my colleagues in the museum for the constant engaging discussions that I share with them. The history of arms is as old as the evolution of humankind itself. The need of human to defend oneself and also to hunt and survive led to the making of the first weapons. Though we may argue that most of these objects were not weapons per se, but tools, one need to understand that the sophistication of large settlements had not yet come to be. So tools and weapons did not look very different from each other. The first weapons were the stone tools. These stone tools, however, have shown scientists and archaeologists the complex working of the brain of the early man. The simple thought of shaping stones to use as a tool, the knowledge of the material, and the mere hand and eye coordination is indication of the process of evolution. The simple tool that was used for scavenging developed into a hunting material. From being just a survivor, man became the intelligent predator. Weapons in the Indian subcontinent were found from the excavations at Mohenjo-daro, now in Pakistan, include axes, spears, maces, slings, bows, and arrows, and few specimens of daggers and swords that can be counted as the early weapons from a civilization. However, we are not going to talk about the evolution of arms, but the collection housed in the Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj Vastu Sanghalaya, CSMVS Museum. The CSMVS has a small collection of arms and armor that consists of variety of swords, daggers, shields, helmets, long barrel guns, pistols, and gunpowder flasks. Most of the objects belong to the period of 17th to 19th century. Part of the collection is displayed on the second floor of the main building of the museum. Kingdoms and empires in India owned large armies, battled with each other, had armories that were silekhana, were well versed with technology and warfare. Some are chronicled, but most are not. So we often turn to sculptures which serve as visual references. Though one needs to be very careful and treat cautiously while using such visual references, We must not forget that though the stories, myths and legends are old, but the physical representation is quite close to the real one. This beautiful example of stone sculpture of King Sal, who is out and about hunting, shows a beautiful short sword that he's carrying in his hand. This sculpture highlights the slaying of the lion by the king in the foreground. Due to the proportion of the lion, one often misses the details. The king is fast advancing towards him in big strides with a raised, straight and broad sword in his right hand and a shield in his left. There is also a dagger hanging on his waist. It could also be a short sword. One can admire the beautiful hilt and sheath carved in the stone image. The shield in his left hand is visibly cushioned for the protection of his palm. The artist has depicted the earlier sequence of the king hunting in the forest by carving a smaller figure of the king on a richly caparisoned galloping horse behind at a distance. Here too, the king carries a dagger or a short sword on his waist. We do see a variety of weapons in the sculptures of India. Bow and arrow, chakra, trident, short and long sword, as well as daggers. A beautiful image of Durga from CSMVS holding a trident raised above her head can be compared to a beautiful trident on display in the museum gallery. Though this gilded trident is made a millennium apart, but one can see the continuity. However, spears and lances were probably preferred over a trident, which remained a symbol of Shaivism and was also associated with Mahishasura Mardini, but may not have been a convenient battle weapon. The museum has several sculptures in bronze and stone and in paintings of Devi killing Mahishasura with her trident. The 10 arms of the goddess carries various attributes and weapons given by various gods in her fight against the Asur army. In another, she is shown carrying a double-edged straight blade sword raised above to strike a blow. These kinds of swords were popular in India, and many early sculptures are seen with such blades. Swords were not just used as weapon. It had deeper meaning and other purposes. Swords were given as gifts, Nazrana. Visiting ambassadors, nobles, and allied chieftains would give swords to kings. The reverse was done as well, wherein a noble was gifted a sword to honor his loyalty. Swords were seen as a pledge to loyalty, a promise to protect the weaker ally. Men swore on the honor of his sword, and this was a universal phenomenon. In India, when swords were gifted or presented, eyes first fell on the blade. It is the blade that is believed to carry the strength and purpose of a sword. In India, a variety of blades were in use. Though large number of water steel blades were found in museums today, it is believed to have become popular during the later medieval times. These swords are characterized by distinctive patterns of banting reminiscent of flowing water. These blades were reputed to be tough, resistant to shattering, and very sharp. The other popular blades were Sakhela, shiny steel blades, and Firangi, foreign-made long blades, were also popular. Sword, or the Hindi word talwar, is a generic term. A sword is comprised of a hilt and a blade. The blade can be single-edged or double, straight or curved. Even the curvature varied, and each specific sword had a name or terminology. Shamshir, talwar, kirej, daab, patta, asi, khanda, and so on. The museum has examples of different kinds of swords in its collection, and you can visit the virtual gallery at Google's Arts and Culture online. The Silekhana or armory of the state or kingdom and had variety of swords. Rulers employed smiths and craftsmen in their workshops to forge weapons of blade. The Indian subcontinent had many popular centers. Some of the swords took names after their region as well, like Sirohi blades, Pratapgarh swords, Talpur swords. Apart from indigenous designs, the Indian subcontinent often adopted designs, that is blade types, from foreign empires and regions. A lot of these designs were tweaked and then remodeled. The sword of a warrior was a prized possession. A king or a noble owned many swords. There are accounts that rulers often named their swords. They often carried different swords on different dates and occasions. Such was their love for swords. Sword and dagger were always kept in the sheath or scabbard and were never taken out without purpose. Drawing a sword out of the sheath meant challenging an opponent. There were many customs associated with swords in India. A warrior took care of his weapon, that is shastra, like he would take care of his vastra, that is costume. The shastra were periodically cleaned, oiled to ensure there is no rusting. The Kshatriya clan in particular laid out his weapons at the feet of Devi on the day of Dashami and offered puja, something which till date continues in many parts of the country. His weapon was his life and pride. It brought him and his family honor and strength. The swords that were carried for war generally had blessings etched on them. The broad and narrow blades of the sword offered generous space for decoration as well. They carried verses of victory, royal emblem, portrait of Devi, mantra. It also carried the name of its owner. On the other hand, swords which were carried to courts, processions and huntings offered a far greater scope to fill the blade with couplets, animal figures and other decorations. The decorations and gilding were elaborate. Some sword blades had hunting scenes running till the tip of the blade. The weapon were not just used for offense and defense, but also had artistic expression. The Meenakari on this scabbard, which you see on the top, covers the entire scabbard with creeper design all over. The hilt as well as the scabbard has Jarakundan work of diamond. The eyes of the, as you see on the left hand side, the eyes of the tiger are inlaid with cat stone, whereas the eyes of the two crocodiles on the quillen are inlaid with rubies. Swords, especially khanda, also served as a proxy for groom in the wedding. If for any reason the groom was unable to be physically present on his wedding, his khanda was sent in his stead. In Rajasthan, this is called khanda marriage. The bride then took one phera with the sword and the rest of the three pheras were taken with the groom in person. Even today, grooms from many communities in India carry sword on their wedding. Hunting scenes and animals were often etched elaborately on the hilts of the swords. They offered a more practical space for design. Hills in India had unique journey of its own. The owner of a sword definitely understood the importance of a comfortable grip of the hilt. The design and shape of hills was rather organic, and each generation of ruler, each region modified the hilts. If a hilt was broken or damaged, the blade was fitted in a new hilt and the old hilt was thrown away. The museum has beautiful collection of jade hilts. As you can see, this horse-headed hilt made in the 17th century. Yet we see hilts of different shapes and size and material. The museum has parrot-head hilt, ram-head hilts. Some hilts were made of jade, some were made of stone, horn, while some were enameled and gilded and jeweled. The jeweled hilts were also used as wealth that were stored and when needed sold off. The museum has this beautiful Totamukhi parrot hilt sword, which is published in the museum collection. Equally treasured weapons of the warriors were the daggers. Dagger too is a general term used for a variety of weapons with short blades that were carried hidden or flaunted on the waist sash, kamarpatta, of its owner. These small weapons of blade were popular in India. It could be used for hand-to-hand combat or to attack a person in close range, to strike with a punch and leave a deep wound. India, in fact, used punch daggers, that is, katars. These double-edged triangular blade katars was very popular throughout India. This weapon is indigenous to the country. The hilt gave ample space for decorations, hunting scenes, inscriptions, verses, were gilded and decorated with precious and semi-precious stones. The blade was is usually plain with only a ridge in the middle, though not a compulsion. Sometimes sword blades were also reused to make the katar blade. Besides katar, a variety of small weapons were popular in India, and the museum has a wide range of churi, khanjar, peshkab, chilnam, khanjrali, bichwa, and many more. Each has a specific blade and hilt type. Like swords, a lot of the dagger types came from different parts of the world and were adapted here, though often with modifications. A beautiful image of Vishnu in the museum sculpture gallery, which you see on your left-hand side, has a small, elegant dagger with an exquisite hilt. The dagger secured on the waist of the chieftain in the painting on the right has a beautiful gilded hilt with a knuckle guard. This resembles the dagger on the cover page of the book, Precious Indian Weapons by Salam Kaufji, curator and collection manager, the Al Sabah Collection, Kuwait. Such visual daggers were gifts or nazrana from one state to another or from nobles to their king. These daggers form the treasury of the household or state. We see numerous paintings where the king or chieftain is seen with a dagger tucked on his waist sash. In this painting, the Maharavat has a visual dagger, a hilt, which is made of jade, tucked away in his waist. The museum has a beautiful dagger from the erstwhile princely state of Rewa in Madhya Pradesh. The dagger is supposed to have belonged to the royal family. The pommel of the hilt has rubies, emeralds, and pearls studded on it, forming a floral pattern. Both sides have a rose, whereas the center is covered with a composite design. The scabbard is covered with beautifully brocaded pink silk and decorative locket and cape to match the hilt. The tassels at the end are made of bell-shaped studded jade pieces decorated with 8 loops of seeded pearls hanging below. There are a number of beautiful, curious bladed weapons in the museum collection. A composite weapon of 3 blades, a maru with shield in the middle and antler on the sides, a beautiful khanjar from Iran. Notice the beautiful dagger and the hilt held by the ivory image of the Nayaka on the left-hand side. According to the style of warfare, designs of weapons were developed. There are a group of weapons that were designed to be carried concealed. Some weapons were intelligently concealed within walking sticks, chhari, armrest, or crutch, and some weapons were even concealed within another weapon, like axes, which had small sharp blades screwed at the end of the handle. But the most interesting of all was the Waghnag, that is tiger claw shaped all steel weapon that you see in the right hand side of your screen. This tiny weapon that could be easily concealed within the palm of its wearer was famously associated with the Maratha ruler Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj. In this portrait, he holds his favorite gauntlet sword and a long straight blade sword. Another constant with the rulers, nobles, and soldiers were the shields. The shields found in India are usually round and made of rhinoceros hide and were were all steel. A lot of the shields, especially the steel ones, had cushioning at the back to protect the fingers on the grip from the force of impact. Owing to the utility of it, most of the shields are plain. However, the knobs were usually gilded or even had designs. But there are shields which were carried to courts for ceremonial use that had designs like hunting scenes, war, floral motifs, sun and moon, among others. Shields were also part of Nazrana and dowries. Shields made of animal hide were usually light, handy, strong and durable and were preferred to metal shields. The surface of this large rhinoceros hide shield is lacquered in black and painted over it. You see the image on your left hand side. It depicts four lions attacking blackbirds and bulls. The space in between is filled with plants and creepers to indicate a forest. The border of the shield has a delicate creeper design. While the other shield is made of tortoise shell, though the shield is light, it is very sturdy. One of the star pieces of the museum is a set of all steel body armor, arms guard, and shield with Kotkari work. The museum has a small collection of armor, all steel breastplate and backplate, chainmail armor, as well as arm guards and helmets. Most battle armors were simple with minimal designs, but some again offered space for hunting and war scenes, or as simple as calligraphic inscription calling on the protection and victory of his owner. Few also have names of the owners written on them. There's a beautiful sculpture of Shiv in the Sir Shri Pratap Singh Museum, Srinagar, Kashmir, where he is wearing a beautiful body armor. It is an 8th-9th century sculpture that shows he is wearing a scaled armor, probably made of leather, secured and decorated with a belt. We also see men and animal wearing armor in various Indian paintings. Early references to Indian arms and armor are also found in Greek literature. Indo-Greek and Kushan coins have portraits of kings and their armor and swords. In this coin of Chandragupta II, he is depicted with a bow. The use of bow in India is ancient. We know that archery was used in battles as well as hunting. Though not many bows have survived, but ample pictorial references are available. It remained a popular weapon in India. Numerous paintings on the theme of love as well depict the use of baan and teer by the sakhi or sakha playing Cupid to the couple. Mace, gada, is associated with Vishnu, require a lot of strength to wield it. There are paintings of Mahabharata showing Duryodhan and Bhim fighting each other with their favorite weapon, mace. It is, however, difficult to say if mace was a popular weapon of war. They were certainly carried to break open doors and even for exercise. It would require great strength to wield the maces in the CSMVS collection. Besides swords and daggers, there are other weapons that were used in wars or trainings. Spears, lances, axes of various kinds. Some were battle axes, while some other carried by ordinary soldiers to clear off bushes and shrubs on the path. Another weapon was the chakra. The chakra was not just used as a boomerang to slice, but could also be held in the hand and used like a dagger. A variety of material was used to make this weapon: animal hide, shell, ivory, nephrite, steel, bone, stone, and so on. The materials were not chosen out of fancy alone. They had a purpose. Some were selected for their natural shape, like horns, while some were selected for their weight. Some were believed to have healing properties, like walrus ivory, apparently reduced swelling and reacted to poison. Interestingly, most of the ivory hills were walrus ivory and not elephant tusk. These bladed weapons were popular up till the early 20th century. They were largely replaced by firearms in the 18th century. The museum does not have many firearms in its collection. One is aware of the history of firearms in India. There are numerous paintings depicting men carrying firearms in war, processions, or using them in hunting. There are visual records of usage of cannons as well. Visitors to the museum often miss the cannons that are on display in the garden area. At one of the gates of the museum, there is a 6 feet long mid-19th century cannon on display. The cannon was unearthed in Mumbai in the year 1993, and then it came to the museum. There are two small cannons displayed near the garden at the main entrance of the museum. Cannons remind us of forts and tedious battles. In the medieval times, cannons have been a decisive factor in the battle sport. It played a crucial role in the architectural designs in building the defense of forts. Rulers had the habit of naming their cannons as well as putting their own name and coat of arms on them. From the heavy cannons, I would now like to divert your attention to the museum's delicate and exquisite gunpowder flask. The museum has a handful of beautiful gunpowder flasks in silver, nephrite, mother of pearl, and ivory. This 17th century ivory primer is undoubtedly a masterpiece in the collection of CSMBS. In the shape of a leaping antelope, it is devoid of any unnecessary decoration. There are examples of similar flasks from the same period in other collections, but this small ivory object is a perfect example of the Indian craftsmanship. The antelope is almost alive and my favorite piece from the museum collection. The CSMBS gallery is popular with tourists across region, age, and gender. To a common man, arms have a direct visual reference to stories from the past. It is simple, yet enigmatic and visually powerful. Of course, it tells stories of power and bravery. And at the same time, one often finds oneself lost visualizing, standing in front of these objects in a world where they are probably part of the past, stretching their arm that holds a sword and rules a kingdom. But arms are not just about wielding power. It is also about peace. It is importantly about respecting the sacrifices it demands to let us live in peace with our rights and freedom. When you visit the museum to see these weapons of wonder, stop to look at the strength of the blade, design of the hilt, the craftsmanship behind the decorations. Each piece demands attention. The museum offers these objects to your admiration with great care. Thank you for your continuous support and do visit the museum.
Oh, you're done, right? I can stop recording.
Stop video. Yes, please stop recording.
Okay.
Wait, what's the... In this coin of Chandragupta II, he is depicted with a bow. So, we'll stop for the author. So, let's start recording.
Sam, now that we will be starting, is the final recording, okay? The earlier one we'll just cut out. Okay? Once you mute yourself, then she'll start.
Okay, I'm muting in 2 seconds. Okay, bye.
Start. I want to thank the museum for giving me this opportunity to talk about the arms collection in the museum. I want to specially thank my seniors, Mr. Mukherjee, DG, CSMVS, and Mrs. Manisha Nene, Director, for their constant guidance and support. I take this opportunity to also thank my colleagues in the museum for the constant engaging discussions that I share with them. The history of arms is as old as the evolution of humankind itself. The need of human to defend oneself and also to hunt and survive led to the making of the first weapons. Though we may argue that most of these objects were not weapons per se, but tools, one need to understand that the sophistication of large settlements had not yet come to be. So tools and weapons did not look very different from each other. The first weapons were the stone tools. These stone tools, however, have shown scientists and archaeologists the complex working of the brain of the early man. The simple thought of shaping stones to use as a tool, the knowledge of the material, and the mere hand and eye coordination is indication of the process of evolution. The simple tool that was used for scavenging developed into a hunting material. From being just a survivor, man became the intelligent predator. Weapons in the Indian subcontinent were found from the excavations at Mohenjo-daro, now in Pakistan, include axes, spears, maces, slings, bows, and arrows, and few specimens of daggers and swords that can be counted as the early weapons from a civilization. However, we are not going to talk about the evolution of arms, but the collection housed in the Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj Vastu Sanghalaya, CSMVS Museum.